you've been with us for a while, you know the technical issues are often fun things we deal with here. And several, I guess a couple of months ago, on this new computer, we were attempting to do OBS, which puts up the pictures and that sort of thing, and it stopped working. Well, it's working this morning. We've tested it a number of times. We'll see if we can make it through the rest of today with it cooperating. So, all right, we're starting off with it working. Ruggero Deodato, the director of Cannibal Holocaust, passed away before the new year began at the age of 83. Certainly had an impact on the industry, somebody who heavily inspired Eli Roth. Of course, the Cannibal Holocaust was a very controversial film when it came out way back in the 1980s for, of course, its extreme level of sadomasochism and actual animal slaughter being involved with the film. It was so realistic that he was dragged into court because people thought that he had actually killed people. Of course, thankfully, that was not the case. His career did continue on. Phantom of Death in 87, Body Count in 86, The Barbarians also in 87, House in the Age of Park in 1980, and 2019's part of Deathcember. He had a segment in that as well. Of course, the news came from The Sun and several Italian papers, and while a controversial filmmaker, certainly, he definitely had an impact on the industry. Someone who also had an impact on the industry and got her start back with Roger Corman was Catherine Cyran. She was an Emmy-nominated filmmaker and writer and producer who passed away at the age of 59, right before Christmas, December 24th of last year. She was a screenwriter for Corman. Slumber Party Massacre 2 was one of hers. She also did quite a bit of directing for, a lot of different people, including more family-friendly side of things like Homecoming for the Holidays and Christmas Duet for ABC Family. She developed the martial arts series Blood Fist and worked as a writer for Universal Pictures on a number of projects. She was also a novelist, The Island of the Glass Great Auk, and quite a list of credits. And 59 is only a few years older than I am. And always a shame to see someone with as much talent and skill pass away so young. But of course, our condolences go out to the families of both. And of course, again, the impact on the industry is something that, even though they're gone, they definitely leave a legacy that's something to be admired. Bambi. Bambi the Reckoning. Bambi the Reckoning is looking for a writer. Yes, it's true. There are postings online at the various job writing sites that you can basically go in. If you're a professional, you can be hired to, looking for gigs. Bambi the Reckoning from Jagged Edge Productions is seeking a professional writer to come on board for Bambi the Reckoning, for the same production company that brought you Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey. The producers already have a concept in mind and want to begin working on it, and are seeking a writer for the new project. The writer has to have previously published horror work that has been made into a film or a short. We will need to see past examples of work for consideration. Now, you only have till February 15th to apply for this. And that's because our turnaround time is looking at beginning shooting in early March. This is not a particularly huge paid gig here, folks. It's about $3,000. But hey, if you want to get your foot in the door, there you go. And speaking of getting foots in the door or trying to come through the door, we have a poster and the new trailer for Evil Dead Rise. The trailer, or a band trailer, is currently out on various places, including YouTube. And it looks like what you kind of hope it's going to be for an Evil Dead film. Certainly a lot of violence and gore and some humor making its way in there as well. But definitely leaning into the darker aspects of the series. The film follows the troubled family. Certainly based on the trailer, it's going to be very troubled. Two sisters who and the children of one of the sisters as they deal with the invasion of the evil dead. We get a new version of the Necronomicon in here, and discussions from the folks behind it indicate that it is actually meant to be a new version, a slightly different edition of the Necronomicon is the one we've seen before. The film is very much in the vein of what you would expect for the Evil Dead, and so definitely something to look forward to if you are a fan. We also got a trailer and logo for the new Renfield film. This is the one where Nicolas Cage stars as Dracula. Nicholas Holt is playing Renfield, and the trailer very much leans into the comedy aspect of having a very bad boss when your bad boss happens to be the king of the vampires. And certainly a lot of energy and humor in the trailer. And we get our first really good look of Cage playing Dracula. Certainly the relationship between the two characters is not exactly the best boss and employee relationship. That's coming to us April 14th. And certainly going to be a lot of fun. And we got this new poster for Scream 6, which has Ghostface as the New York City subway map. Now, all the stops on this map are the people that Ghostface has killed. The different colors represent the different lines or the different films in the series. That's also coming out here pretty quickly, about in March. And production has started on the new Alien movie. Now, this is, pre-production has started. They're getting a full production here in 2023. Fede Alverez is the director on this. We don't have any actual news about what it's going to cover. And it's been pretty quiet since the last time we had this announcement, several months ago. But the Film and Television Industry Alliance website, it is currently going under the title of Alien Romulus. It's going to start shooting in February. And that seems like a title that might change, but we'll see what happens there. No plot details, of course. They're going to keep that under wraps. Ridley Scott is producing. And this is something that is set separately from anything we've seen before in terms of this isn't a sequel to Prometheus or Covenant or anything like that. So, it looks like it's going to go directly to Hulu like Predator did. So the new Predator Prey film. So we'll see what happens with that as well. Now, of course, if you're a fan of The Purge, the movies and TV series, we are getting a new film. Even in the pandemic, the last one made $76 million. So that's not too shabby considering the budgets on these are relatively low. Their profit margin is pretty solid. Frank Grillo is returning to this series. And playing Leo Barnes, and franchise creator James DeMonaco is coming back as well and be the director. This is I think he only directed the first two, and now he's returning for the new one. He has written all five films, has not directed these in a while. Quite frankly, $53 million was the budget for the entire series so far. It made $535 million. At the box office, so definitely a nice return on the investment. No news on when, of course, we're getting that. And Megan Fox is going to return to the horror thriller space in the new sci-fi thriller horror film, Subservience. Tell Death director is behind this, S.K. Dale, and Will Honey from Escape Room Tournament of Champions and April McGuire from Lost Girls are the writers on this. Filming is going to start today, as a matter of fact, over in Bulgaria. And the premise here is about a struggling father who purchases a domestic artificial intelligence, a simulated person, an AI android creature to help care for his house, played by Megan Fox. She begins to get awareness and turns deadly. This continues a current trend we've seen of going back into this. If you're a horror fan, you know, in the 70s and 80s, we actually got a lot of evil computer stories, evil AI stories. Everything old is new. Again, of course, technology's a lot further along now, but apparently we're going to see a different side of Megan Fox, according to the folks behind this. And Corey Deschon is making his feature film debut with the upcoming horror film Daughter. Dead Central has got exclusive photos and this poster. To go over to their website to check out all of their photos that they've got. It is a film about a cult, but it may be about an apocalypse as well. The premise here is a young woman is kidnapped and inducted into a very disturbed family as their new surrogate daughter. She makes her way through this very disturbed relationship she's suddenly in. Awful secrets about the past are revealed, and dark implications about the future are revealed as well. Casper Van Dien, Elise Din, Vivian Ngo, and Ian Alexander are starring in this one. It's going to come out on February 10th in theaters and digital, and then it's going to make its way to DVD in May. And looks like we're getting a remake of the classic creature feature, Them. Up composers Michael Giacchino, who of course was the director of the very popular Disney Plus Werewolf by Night, is going to be the directing the feature version remake of Them. This, of course, is in the 1954 giant ant movie. Definitely a classic in the field, and something that could be very interesting with modern technology. He's a huge fan of the film. He said, there's always a movie in your mind that never leaves your head. For me, it's Them. It wasn't until much later that I learned what it was about, the nuclear age. And Jason Hunt and I have talked about the impact of the nuclear age on certain films, especially Japanese cinema. And certainly there was a whole slew of films in America in the 50s and 60s about the impact of radiation, the post-apocalyptic implications of the nuclear bomb. So something to look forward to. Now, we don't have any kind of news about when this is going to happen yet. Apparently, looking for a writer on the project. And this one hits a little close to home, because it's friends of ours. Patrick Ray, who is a Kansas City-based filmmaker and a friend of mine. I've actually worked on a couple of his films over the years. He's got a new horror film coming out called They Wait in the Dark. It's coming out in February. There is a trailer on the way, but we have one photo released here. Sarah McGuire there on the left is also a friend of mine. Always nice to see those folks I know getting the jobs and doing the work. It's coming from Smart Mouth Productions. Sarah plays Amy, and her adopted son, Adrian, are on the run from Amy's abusive ex-husband. I'm sorry, excuse me, ex-girlfriend. Sorry, Judith. Lori Catherine Winkle, also someone I know. They are hiding and desperate to stay hidden. They take refuge in an abandoned farmhouse that Amy's family had outside her Kansas hometown. But supernatural circumstances arise and begin haunting Adrian. Judith is in pursuit, and they are locked in a showdown between both the supernatural and physical threats. So Chris Bilsma and Megan Flynn also are in the cast. Again, people that we know. Always nice to see the work. Very cool. And if you're a fan of James Wan and Leigh Whannell, well, Dead Silence is making its way to 4K March 28th. There's a couple of different versions. One has a couple different slip cover designs, and those are available for pre-order now. And a personal favorite, EXORCIST 3 is making its way to 4K Ultra HD. It is March 28th. The first Exorcist film, of course, is an amazing classic. Exorcist 2 was a gigantic disappointment and widely regarded as one of the worst films of all time. Exorcist 3 didn't necessarily take the box office on fire, but it's a very solid entry in the series and gives George C. Scott a chance to return to the horror space. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. And the late Larry Drake returns to horror in Dr. Giggles, the 1992 slasher film. It's finally getting a Blu-ray release here in U.S. from Scream Factory, March 21st. Larry Drake, of course, had quite a successful career in the 80s and 90s before passing away way too young. And Dr. Giggles is definitely a 1990s horror film. Let's just say that. It's a guilty pleasure for a lot of folks. And to the surprise of not really anyone, except it's Netflix, so you never know, Wednesday has been renewed for season two. And of course, the numbers were very, very solid. This was pretty much an expected thing. But again, it's Netflix, which has a history of making very interesting choices for not reviewing shows past first seasons or second seasons. And the producers say that they're looking forward to having a little more involvement of the rest of the Addams family in the series, although the show is called Wednesday and it's meant to be focused on Wednesday. But definitely, a few episodes here and there. But they feel like they've just touched the surface with these characters and continue to do a lot more with it. Unfortunately, because it is Netflix, $18.99 has been canceled. Their first season is their only season. Now, there's been a lot of blowback from a lot of folks who were reviewing this show in the first season online. And that's not terribly surprising. It's from the folks who produced the very, very popular series Dark for Netflix, which was able to run its entire story. There's horror elements and sci-fi elements, and 1899 had a pretty solid cast, but unfortunately, for whatever reasons, Netflix had decided not to continue it. The creators went online and posted their own regrets that they weren't able to complete their story, but who knows? In this era of other people picking things up, maybe it'll find a home somewhere else. Probably not, but it'd be nice. And Yellow Jackets Season 2 is on its way, coming out on March 24th. There has been a lot of people added to the cast for this time. Francois Arnault from Midnight Texas, Nicole Maines from Darby and the Dead, Nia Shandaya from Truth Be Told have all added to the cast recently. This is, of course, returning cast members. Elijah Woods, Christina Ricci, Juliet Lewis, Lauren Ambrose, Simon Kessel. It's a very, very solid cast for season two. So the very success of season one definitely has made the return to Showtime of the second season not a terribly big surprise. But if you're a fan of the show, it's certainly looking like that cast is very solid. And in this era of things coming back around, there's been a lot of discussion of Buffy the Vampire Slayer getting a reboot or a return. Sarah Michelle Gellar says that she is not interested in playing the part again. Be a bit of a disappointment for a lot of fans, but quite frankly, she says, "I'm very proud of the show we created, and it doesn't need to be done. We wrapped that up. I'm all for them continuing the story because it's a story of female empowerment. I love how the show was left. Every girl who has the power can have the power. It's set up for somebody else to have the power. But the metaphors of Buffy were the metaphors of the horrors of adolescence. I think I look young, but I'm not an adolescent," which is only fair. Do you think Zendaya should continue the role or play a new version of the character? And the folks who are running the Horror Writers of the UK, the Horror Writers Association UK, the co-chairs have decided to step down. Marie O'Regan and Paul Kane, who are both professional writers and very successful writers, have decided to step down after running for being co-chairs for 7 years. The amount of work they've had to put into it, it's like anything else. You're running a con, you're running an organization, you're on the board of something. It takes time and work, and 7 years is a nice long run. They've decided to step down. And there are folks there, of course, if you're over in the UK and you're interested in being on the co-chairs of the UK chapter, you can definitely do that. They're looking for those roles now. But the Horror Writers Association was formed here in the U.S. in 1985 by Joe Lansdale, Karen Lansdale, and Robert McCammon, and of course has gone across the world. And if you're interested, the quarterly e-zine from the Siren's Call publications is got an entry looking for artists and writers for their upcoming spring 2023 issue of the Siren's Call. Short stories, flash and microfiction, horror and dark fiction, and a sub-theme of flora versus fauna on this particular one. You head to the Siren's Call pub.com for more information. And if you are looking forward to the Resident Evil fan remake, I have some bad news. It's not coming. Resident Evil Code Veronica and Resident Evil Remake, both fan remakes that were on the way, they are no longer in production. They have been shut down. Capcom got in touch with the creators of these and asked them, didn't demand, apparently, but asked them sternly, I guess, for the projects to be stopped. Now, part of the issue here is that they're actually using resources that Capcom owns. That's character designs, character elements. Some of the actual code, apparently, is still owned by Capcom, and trademarks and that sort of thing. There was also a donation link, and some of this comes down to whether or not you're doing it for free with no chance of making any money on it, or whether or not you're actually making a profit. So unfortunately, and this is of course not the only fan remakes out there, so some have are still moving forward for various video games, and certainly some still in the horror space, but this particular one is no longer going to be continuing, which is a disappointment. They look pretty good. And we do have a little bit of information about the new Silent Hill. Silent Hill, the short message, was not talked about at the presentation Konami recently had about resurrecting the Silent Hill franchise. So it wasn't mentioned at all. It got its rating back in Korea. And apparently it's been rated now in Taiwan. It's been rated for PlayStation 5. The guy has an entry on the website now of the game synopsis and official artwork. Anita came to an abandoned apartment to meet her friend Maya and somehow woke up to find herself trapped. She must escape her own fears and the monsters lurking in the corridors, discover the truth behind the events that she's trapped in, and try to escape before her own trauma consumes her will to survive. Sounds very much like what you'd expect from a Silent Hill game. And apparently there have been some images that were already leaked from Silent Hill Sakura, which look a lot like the images we're seeing for Silent Hill Short Message. So they may actually be the same thing or connected. And obviously we'll have more news as we get more information about that. That's all I've got for you guys this morning. We look forward to seeing you in the rest of this 2023. We hope that you have a fantastic new year and get all the scary fun you can get.
You know, you talk about what goes around comes around, everything old is new again, not just the AI and the evil computers, but also the haunted dolls, because Megan is out this weekend.
Right.
And looks to be pulling in about, estimated right now, $27 million, which is higher than what anybody was expecting. They were projecting 17 to 20. And 3,400 theaters, that seems to be pretty good for a PG-13 haunted doll horror flick.
The news and of course I try to stay away, I have not seen it yet, so I don't want to get into, you know, I don't want it to necessarily be spoiled, but I do read reviews.
Sure.
And so what I've seen so far indicates that there's a certain amount of fun that is involved in this, and one of the greatest recipes for PG-13 horror. And folks, Hollywood, take a note. I'm right about this. Is don't forget it should be fun. And horror and comedy go hand in hand. So if you find the right balance, you can have a hit. Not to mention that viral video of her dancing.
Yeah.
That took off. There's at the premiere, they had, I don't know, like 8 live dancers doing that dance at the premiere, which apparently the audience was just loved it. So it hit at the right time, and it's apparently got a pretty solid script. So also important, you know, one of those things.
So
I'm looking forward to seeing it.
So when are you putting in your application for Bambi the Reckoning?
You know,
we ought to. I mean, we did do the statement of Randolph Carter.
Yes.
Okay, Bambi the Reckoning in the style of H.P. Lovecraft.
You know what's funny is that, is it The Lodge? I can't really name the film, but there's There's a lot of the various horror websites have been linking this image of Bambi and this image from I can't remember if it's like The Lodge or not, but it's one of the more deer-ish monsters from the last few years in horror films. And it's like, okay, if Bambi looks like a, you know, giant murder beast, right. Okay, this could be fun.
Or The Rock.
Right. Giant, I mean, again, we come back to the first.
Bambi the giant murder beast played by The Rock. I think we could sell that.
Yeah, he may be looking for work right now.
That's what I hear. All right.
Good Morning Multiverse, Saturday morning at 11, 10 Central, only on Sci-Fi for Me TV.